What's up, everybody? It is I, Sigma, and we are back with episode 27 of the BBET GamesCast. I'm joined by Superman Jeff.
Hey, what's going on, people?
As well as Blue Bones.
What's going on? It's your boy.
And we're going to start, not like we always do, with a short story. I just want to tell you guys a little bit about how my Thanksgiving weekend went. For the most part, it was pretty good. I have a really huge family, and we all gathered at my uncle's house in Cherry Hill, and about 60 or so of us were all crammed into his house. Wow. And my family has this yearly tradition where all the they like to call themselves the older generation, like all the parents and grandparents and stuff. They'll gather everyone around where they're hanging out, like the main living room. They're all sitting in a circle, like talking and whatever whatnot. They'll gather everybody around. Usually, they'll get like some kind of PA system, like a microphone and stuff. And they have everyone basically just say, oh, what are you thankful for? And then also give a list of accomplishments that you've done, or basically just what you've done over the course of the year or since the last time most of them maybe have seen you and stuff.
That's pretty nice.
It is nice in sentiment. But over the years, it has kind of turned into a bit of a bragging like time window. And you can tell like there's a bit of a disconnect because like the adults like to basically show off, oh this is what my kids done.
Yeah.
And then the kids, you know, a lot of us are millennials, some of us aren't doing too well. So they don't like to get on the mic and be like, okay, so my cousin just got a brand new job and bought a brand new car, blah blah blah, but you know, I'm still working the same job I've been working for like the past 4 years. I don't really have much to update. I don't really want to say nothing. So it's kind of this push and pull between those two things, and ultimately it's pretty funny because you get a lot of pushback, then you get the adults getting mad that someone didn't do it right, and this, that, and the third.
I can imagine for y'all's generation, it's like an open mic night. Like, you guys...
Right. Like, they asked me and my oldest brother to kind of share MC duties, where we're, like, kind of hosting it and pacing things and telling people who to come up and blah, blah, blah. And that tends to be pretty fun because I'm kind of belligerent on the mic. And, you know, like, my son, Adam, wasn't with me. Like, he was with his mom this Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. So it was just me and my girlfriend, Kia. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everybody likes to ask me, oh, where's Adam? Where's Adam? Where's Adam? Oh, hey, where's Adam? Where's Adam? Where's Adam? So, of course, it's like, I lost him. I don't, like, where do you think he is? Like, it's a holiday. He's not with me. He must be with
his mom.
It should be like, so, he's hiding. Go find him.
Like, I told my uncle he couldn't get off work and stuff. Like,
he's studying abroad.
Right? Like, let him live.
He's a wizard.
But, get off of work.
Afterwards, we actually drove up to Connecticut to see my girlfriend Kia's sister's family. Well, okay. Her family, her sister's house and stuff. So we've been hanging out with them for Friday into Saturday. We drove back from Connecticut, and my tire exploded on the way back. So, like...
spontaneous combustion.
Yeah, because like we're just cruising, all of a sudden you just hear like this loud rumbling, and like there's this big truck to the side of us. So I'm like, yo, is that the truck making all that noise? Like, what the hell going on? Couldn't find out it's not the truck. Like, the car is like rumbling. I had to pull over to the side. We're on like this tiny stretch of highway, so it was dangerous to kind of get out and try to walk around and stuff. So we ended up calling like a tow people. Luckily I had a donut in the trunk, and it was like, it was free for them to just replace it, as long as I had the donut for them to put on it. Like,
oh, that's
charge anything. Yeah, so that was kind of a lucky day. It took like maybe an hour off the trip, but that wasn't too bad.
Okay. So,
that was my Thanksgiving. I don't know if you guys want to share anything about yours or not.
Spontaneous combustion, man. It's a problem that they've been trying to solve. The infernos are running crazy.
Yo, and, you gotta watch Fire Force.
It's been an ongoing issue.
You gotta watch that's reference to?
Yeah, man. It's so good. What have we been playing?
But anywho, we're getting into what we've been playing. Does anybody want to start off?
I can go. I'll go. You know. So I just started playing Jedi Fallen Order. Now, Blue's talking about it so much. I was like, let's give it a shot. Let's see what's going on there. So picked it up. So it comes on. It's like, I think the first one's like Padawan, and there's Jedi, then there's Master Jedi, then there's Grandmaster. So it tells you how much like the difficulties go up for each thing, like enemy aggression, damage, your window for parrying.
The parry window, they actually specify that on every difficulty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Like Grandmaster was like, I was like, no, the parry window was like that much.
Oh, so they want you to be like maxed. Frame perfect. Wow.
Everything else was maxed. And I'm like, nah. It's like, oh, okay, Grand. I was like, okay, Jedi Master. Okay, I can do that. Not bad. Okay. Jedi. I got a little experience with difficult, you know, Souls-like games. So uh-huh. I was like, let's try this out. So go in. It's not too bad once I get used to a specific enemy type. So what I'll do is when I come across an enemy type, I'll fight it over and over and over again just to kind of get it down pat. Mm. So like I came across... am I able to discuss that? I don't know if that's like a spoiler type.
I streamed like the first bit of it. So you could talk about that. And yeah.
Did we get up to Dothamir or no?
Yes.
Okay. So
No. Because I got stuck on that toad dude. That first big frog monster in the beginning. Yeah, no. We didn't talk about Dothamir, but
we'll talk about the toad dude. So this is huge toad.
Yeah.
I fought. Like very early when I first landed on the first planet, and I'm like, what the heck is this thing? And it glowed red and it charged at me and just like murked me. And I'm like, whoa.
But like one hit?
One hit me. And I'm like,
Sigma, remember that was the boss I was fighting on my stream.
Yeah, I remember.
That's the one that was kicking my butt. And he's playing at a harder difficulty.
So I was like, okay, cool. Fine. So the souls in me is always trying to find a way around direct combat. What can mm-hmm. I do? Is there a way around him? Is there something above him? So I let him chase me. I climbed up the ladder. I mean, the little grass. Mm-hmm. Then I jumped. It was jumped down. You can do kind of like not an assassination, but the X button comes up. Yeah. So you can hit him with that. Did a good amount of damage. Turtled him out again. Ran back up. Climbed up back again. Jumped down. Did the same thing.
So that's a lot like that first boss in Dark Souls. Like, what is that? What's that thing called? Yeah, the Warden.
Yeah.
It's like, if you guys don't remember, like, original Dark Souls, one of the first big bosses you meet in, like, the very first area is this massive demon who will kill you in one or two hits. And you can fight him straight up, like, it's kind of a trial by fire to let you know, okay, this game is for me. Or you can look for other options, find a pathway up and around, and then do, like, a diving attack on him mm-hmm. and basically kill him in, like, one or two shots.
Wow.
So, if that's kind of how that boss fight plays out, then it seems like that's kind of an homage to the Soul series, which that whole game seems to kind of be.
This wasn't the boss though. This was the
mini boss.
But so was that Warden though.
Yeah, that's true. This one was. So then I make it to the vault. I come out the vault. There's another frog.
Oh yeah, but it wasn't a mini boss.
No, I'm like, okay, cool. So I spent time fighting him, learning his, like, the tongue lash and stuff like that, and how to dodge him and how to avoid him. I think I fought him, like, maybe, like, 10, 15 times to kind of get him down pat. Then after I left there, we went to, same planet. Nope, different planet. Vesser?
Zepho.
Boom. Yeah, I don't know how I got that out. So I got to Zepho, came across the first little Inquisitor trooper. This dual-wielding dude in black suit with these purple lightning batons.
Yeah, and I'm fighting him. In the trailers and stuff, right?
Oh, my God. It was annoying. So I'm fighting him.
No joke.
And he's trained, too. So he's like, he's doing, like, combos.
And he's talking smack the whole time. Mm-hmm.
And he's like, that'll definitely make you, like, try to rush him. Like, oh, shut up. And you run in there, and then he just catch you off guard.
And he was with another baton trooper, which is a regular baton trooper. So I'm like, okay. And the problem is, I could parry them both, but when I parry one, the other one was already coming in. Mm-hmm. So I had to try to separate them. So I had force push. I got a force push. So I charge it up and just knock them back into a wall, and I start fighting the other one. They did kill me about twice, because even though I force pushed, they recovered pretty fast. I'm like, okay.
Especially the
dude in black, Inquisitor Trooper.
Inquisitor Trooper, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't respond well to force stuff. And sometimes they get even more mad when you do it on them. So it's just, you got to be careful.
How dare you touch me with your filthy force?
Pretty much. Maybe.
Jedi,
that won't work, Jedi.
Like, So last time, I made it back around. I came back down. I'm like, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I push the regular trooper off the edge with a force push. The Inquisitor trooper parried his stuff and then hit with a downward strike. Mm-hmm. Like, hit him with that twice, and he was dead. I'm like, oh, okay. That downward strike is like, I guess they can't block it, mm-hmm. and it does a good amount of damage to him. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to use that more often. So just a good... Exactly.
It's a good long wind-up, though.
It is. So you got to, like, you got to anticipate the spacing and everything. So you're like, okay. I did. It's a good game. I mean, I love the... Some questions about some visuals, like some characters, how some other characters look, I don't really care for. Mm-hmm. But the way the world looks, the way they incorporate lore from Clone Wars, from different things, like, oh, I know about that.
So should I watch that show first, like, before I actually jump into that game?
Like, you can watch it in conjunction.
You can watch it in conjunction. Like, while playing it, you're thinking.
I started Clone Wars over again, and I've been watching it. And I just passed a part where they talk about some sisters that I'm not going to name, so I don't spoil it for you. Mm. But, and then I went and played the game. Oh, they just talked about that. But even if you get it vice versa, you hear it in the game, and then you see it in the show, they don't take away from each other. Because it doesn't give you a full-on, doesn't give you a full-on description. If you see it in the game, and you're like, oh, that's okay.
So
you
they're see more complementary to one another's lore.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
They give you... two different feelings. If you see it in the game first and then you watch it in the show, you're like, oh, so that's what they are. But if you see it in the show first, you see it in the game, like, oh, that's pretty cool. They talk about that.
That's what they become.
Yes.
In the game.
Cool. Mm-hmm.
Crap.
Yeah. And you're like, oh, okay. Besides that, I finished the last battle for Pokemon to finish the base game.
Hey. Oh, really? Wow. I'm just now approaching, like, the first gym.
What?
Yeah, I've been taking my time with that game.
Oh, man. It's like, I'm not going to spoil anything, but, like, I beat it. And then they do have a pretty good endgame. I didn't get into that yet, but they have one last quest. Well, obviously, you can try to catch the legendaries that for the game or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much it. I mean, since we're going into Pokemon, you might as well pick it up and go into your experience.
So yeah, I haven't actually played a ton more Pokemon. Well, sort of, I kind of did. I did play a lot of Pokemon, especially over the long weekend because I had my Switch with me. One thing is I have Joy-Con drift. Like, my left Joy-Con is kind of busted. Like, it's to the point where it's forcing me to run to the right, and it's so bad that if I try to run to the left, it acts as if I'm, like, just very slightly moving it.
Oh, no.
So, like, I, like, move super slow. You know, like, Jeff, you know how, like, Pokemon that are, like, kind of strong will chase you. Like, there's no way to get away from them when you tiptoe and they come full speed after you. So, like, they were, like, bodying my team and stuff. So I had to basically stop using that and just, like, use my
Pokemon. That's like a card I can only turn right. You gotta make all right
turns. Right.
It's like your trainer is Zoolander.
That should be
you can't turn left.
That should be like a whole meme, him trying to run away from, like, a beware and just getting uppercutted because he can't run.
Oh, boy. Yeah, so I had to give up on using it in handheld mode, and, like, I just propped it up on the stand I got and was using my Pro Controller. Yeah. But, yeah, I don't know what I'm going to do because I kind of don't.
Oh, they fixed that for free? Away.
I mean, they do, but then I'm just not going to have Joy-Cons. But whatever, I guess that's probably what I'll have to do. But anyway, I saw that I was basically getting to that first gym against Milo, the grass trainer, or whatever. And I went, like, okay, a couple of my Pokemon, like my starter, for example, have made it to, like, their second evolution. But I kind of wanted everyone to be on their second evolution, so I went back and just kept kind of grinding. So I was trying to build up my Nickit, which became, a Thievius or something. And I really like how that little fox evolved into, because he has, like, a little bandito mustache, right? And then he has, like, a little mask over his face, but that's, like, his fur color. Like, I really like that fox. And he's pretty strong now. Now, he's not, like, my strongest Pokemon, but I just really like using him. Like, he kind of comes in clutch with his particular moveset. Like, I won't go into it because I feel like it's a strategy that I could eventually use on somebody.
Man, it's funny because I saw you streaming it the other day,
right?
And I was like, man, he's pushing Nickit to the limit.
Like, right, like, that Pokemon is not strong, but I was making him put in work.
Yeah, Yeah. I was like, dang, he likes this one. And every psychic Pokeball you came across was
whooping. Oh my god. Confusion is so strong in that game. Like,
especially against Dark, though.
Confusion is Psycho Slash.
Yeah, I haven't come across anything that does Psycho Slash, but I did catch it's like the first
a,
ghost
It's like
type.
A psychic cutting move. Like you see these little blades come out at you. But yeah, Confusion is... But yeah, like you said, especially against Dark.
Yeah, so I'm gonna try to get me some Pokemon I can use that, because it seems to be really, really powerful. And yeah, weirdly enough, a lot of my Pokemon are Dark. I don't know if that's a what Shield I thing or if that is a Galar region thing, is that a lot of the Pokemon are like something and Dark.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You can pick up that Rapidash, because that's, the Ponyta, that's...
Oh, yeah, I haven't come across that yet.
Shield specific.
Yeah, the little rainbow unicorn Ponyta.
And that's a psychic Pokemon.
Oh, cool. I didn't know that. Yeah, I definitely want to catch that eventually. But, yeah, I'm still having fun with it. I was just doing a bunch of grinding, kind of not following the story all the way straight through. So maybe I'll be a little overpowered by the time the game ends if I keep this rate, but it'll probably take me a while to actually finish the game.
Well,
so.
We'll see if you are.
Yeah, we'll see, son. We'll stream a Pokemon battle.
Ooh. Yeah. Yeah, what's the battle?
But yeah, other than...
spin my hat around.
Other than Pokemon, just yesterday or 2 days ago, my latest review came out for a game called Sniper Ghost Warrior Contracts. Very ridiculous name.
Absolutely ridiculous.
But I actually like the game a lot. If you've heard of the Sniper series, you'd be forgiven for being confused with the Sniper Elite series, because they're both extremely similar. They're two different games by like two completely different companies. I tried to find out if there was some kind of lineage, like one split off from the other, like, you know, so many companies do back in the day, like Rock Band and Guitar Hero, for example.
Guitar Hero.
But it just seems it's just two different companies that just made Sniper-specific games. One, the Sniper Elite series is like third person, but then you go in first person when you snipe, and then the Sniper colon whatever games are first person. So I'm doing the Sniper colon whatever thing, and apparently the last couple of games were open world, and this one takes a ton of inspiration from the Hitman series. So it's not one big open world game, it's like a bunch of separate big maps.
Missions, yeah.
And so you'll be dropped in a map, and you have all sorts of gadgets and tools and stuff. Like, you have, like, special bullets, like EMP bullets, DARPA bullets that, like, don't react to the wind and stuff.
Yeah.
You have gadgets like auto snipers that you can place in certain locations, and then you go elsewhere and then, like, have it mark targets and, like, snipe people for you to, like, coordinate shots. Like, it was actually really, really fun to, like, play around that sandbox. It reminded me a lot of Far Cry, like, how you would, like, mess with, like, the enemy outposts. And, like, there were, like, multiple angles you could, like, attack it from. And a little bit of, like, Metal Gear Solid, because it's primarily a stealth game. Like, you don't go in there guns blazing. Like, if enemies see you, like, they surround you, they'll kill you pretty
quick.
And
it's done.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But they are very generous when it comes to you keeping a distance. Because, one, your sniper is crazy quiet. So, like, even when you're, like, closer than you think you should be, you'll be able to snipe someone and they won't know where the shot came from. And enemies who are, like, maybe 20 feet away from each other, for whatever reason, they don't like to cross one another's, like, vision cones. So if you snipe somebody who's just in a corner in front of a door, it's rare that another soldier's going to just walk in front of them and be alerted because this body's dead. So, like, you can pick off most of a camp before having to go in and finish off everybody else and stuff. So it's satisfying in that way. Like, you don't feel hamstrung by, you know, picking one dude to snipe and then everything goes crazy.
Yeah.
So the story was basically... dumb. It's like a bad Tom Clancy. Like, think of The Division, where, like, stuff is happening, but, like, you don't care.
Oh, wow. I mean, that's kind of what The Division was, but...
Yeah. It's like, okay, they're telling me about things, and this sounds pretty serious, but, yeah, I don't care. But, yeah, so I was pretty, pretty positive on it. The levels have a lot of replay value, because as you're completing challenges, like, you're getting money because you're, like, a mercenary. It's contract killing or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting money. You can buy more stuff, like new guns, new gadgets, or whatever, and then go back in and, like, do, like, harder challenges in those same levels. And, like, you're more familiar with the levels. You're like, oh, before when I shot this guy, I didn't know that there was a pathway up to this water tower or something. So, like, you can look down or whatever. So it gives you avenues to kind of keep coming back, and I really enjoyed it. And after the last game I reviewed, that stinker of Rune 2, like... I was kind of happy to play something that was actually fun the whole time. So that's okay. Pretty much it for me.
That's what's up.
Blue, what did you get into?
So it's kind of funny right now in our gaming lives. Jeff and I are kind of switching places where he just started Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, and he finished the base story of Pokemon. I'm picking up Pokemon tomorrow, and yesterday I just finished Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order.
That's funny.
Yo, the ending is so satisfying.
Really now?
It is so satisfying. And I'm not just saying that. I'm saying that as a Star Wars fan for sure, right?
Right.
But I feel like looking at the story subjectively, or I should say objectively, everything makes sense, and there's lots of room for DLC. I'm waiting for the next expansion. Like, let's have more of this story. And there's a lot of people saying, like, we want more. It wrapped up so nice.
So, I mean, would you be able to answer this without spoiling anything? Like, do you see the main character getting more story and missions, or is it open enough where new people could be involved in it? And if it's a spoiler to say one or the other, then you don't have to answer that.
I actually would say yes to both. I could see some solo adventures from some of the characters that you see at the end of the story. And the main character, I'd like to see him push more. So, yeah, because he's got a really cool goal by the end of it. And it's, yeah, I'm trying not to spoil a whole bunch, but it's great.
Just tell him. He's trying to open up a Jedi-themed ramen shop.
Exactly. Ah, shoot. Why did you tell him, bro?
Is there ramen in Star Wars universe?
There probably is.
I'm sure it's like orange.
It's probably like blue.
Yeah, so I'm really excited for Pokemon. You guys have been talking about it for a while.
What version are you getting?
So I've been dealing with this, right? So, Jeff, you got Sword, right? Sigma mm-hmm. got Shield.
Yep.
And I was like, if I had gotten this before one of y'all, it would be an easy choice. But I think I'm going to go Shield. I love tanking in general.
That's cool, because I can trade with you two and get things I don't have, so that works out.
There we go.
I feel like most people who got it went the Sword route, though.
Yeah.
Which is partly why I went Shield. Because a lot of people, like everybody I was seeing who bought it online were all posting pictures of Sword. I'm like, did anybody buy Shield?
That's good.
I was going to get Shield, and I was looking at a comparison of what Pokemon were on each, mm-hmm. and just so happened it had the ones that I wanted. So I was like, okay. I like, if somebody actually gets Shield, then it'll be easier. You know, we can kind of switch, you know, trade Pokemon. You know,
if you bring something good to the table, for sure. You know what I'm saying? Supply is low and demand is high. You know what I'm saying? So, I've been playing Hearthstone this week. Jeff and I played a lot of matches. He finally got the hang of his deck by the end of the week.
I had to make some new cards. My cards were... What happens, I played a long time ago, and so my cards were no longer standard. They were kind of...
They call them wild.
Yeah, and Magic call them modern or whatever. So they weren't using standard. So my deck was very limited to the random hodgepodge and stuff that they mixed into it. Mm. So I was like, you're actually able to destroy cards or take their essence, whatever you want to call it, and then you're able to craft other cards you don't own that are in that deck by paying the essence to craft them. So that's a cool thing. So my deck is built around stalling people, kind of disabling them, but I'm able to summon. The good thing about that game is you're able to summon creatures you don't necessarily own. So it'll allow you to pull a random mage from the database of mage cards. So you don't actually have to own. Yeah, you don't have to actually own that card. You can pull it from a database. It'll pull you a random card from out of all the mage cards in Hearthstone. Yeah. So it's pretty cool.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, we played a lot of that this week. I need to get back on. I need to update my deck because now Jeff's stuff is updated. So, you know, I got to keep up with the Joneses. But unfortunately, I don't have too much new this week. You know, it was just those. I had a pretty rough week. You know, it's just one of those things you just got to keep pushing.
I feel you.
That's part of gaming, perseverance, you know what I mean? And patience and all that fun stuff. So That's me this week. That's all what right. I've been playing.
Well, to keep it on the subject of pushing.
Ooh. I'm glad I'll be able to help you out with that.
Our first topic, Cyberpunk 2077, is set to feature fully motion captured sex scenes.
Yeah. It's showing what it really is about. You know what I'm saying?
So, how do you guys feel about, because to be honest, I don't think this has ever been a thing before. Like, you remember there was a big controversy with Mass Effect for having
what they called
interactive sex scenes, but that wasn't the case. It was just a cutscene. It was very short. It was tasteful, but it was like kind of just shots of like a butt here, like people embracing there. GTA got in trouble for the hot coffee mod, which was supposed to be an interactive sex scene that they pulled from the game, but then hackers kind of put back
found
in. Right. But this is, well, The Witcher also kind of gets raunchy, right? But yeah, I don't think any of that is motion captured. Like, it's just animators, you know, basically animating dolls, you know? Mm-hmm. But these are actors, you know, pretending to have sex, and then those characters in this game are going to be actually having sex. But who knows how it's shot, you know? Is it going to look like straight up porn, or is it going to look like every other Game of Thrones episode, which actually looks like straight up porn now I think about it?
Yeah, I was like, that's almost the same thing.
So, like, what do you guys take on this method of doing a sex scene in a game? Like, it's new, it's exciting, but how does it make you feel?
For me, it doesn't add or take away from the game, whether it was in there or it's not in there for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's always just one of those things that, let's just be honest, I played Grand Theft Auto. Mm-hmm. I was never going around picking up hookers and robbing them. Some people did that in video. Do some crazy shit. Take a hooker in a cab, take it to the top of a mountain, and drive the car off. Like, shit like that. Like, you get people who just do crazy stuff like that. But for me, like, that being into the game doesn't add anything, an extra layer to it for me. Mm-hmm. You know, like you said, most games, they'll allude to it. They'll hint at it, or they'll show parts or glimpses, but never like you actually control it. To me, that's like, for me, it's like a needless mini game.
Speaking of that, that's what God of War did, remember?
Yeah,
it was like
in the room with the two girls.
But I mean, they didn't show anything, but they had you kind of like do a quick time event where you were having sex with like a bunch of women.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and they've done that in multiple games, you know what I mean? They had whole games based around sex. One of the biggest examples I remember back in the day, Leisure Suit Larry.
Larry, yep.
You know what I'm saying?
But, I mean, to be fair, that's more of like a story, like it was kind of a comedic story-driven thing.
True.
That was based around, so at least it served a bit of a purpose. It was kind of like a raunchy comedy.
I think with Cyberpunk 2077, it's in the spirit of immersion.
Mm-hmm.
I really do believe it. And you know, lots of people are going to be, I don't know, people are going to enjoy it. And that's what they're supposed to do. So I don't see anything wrong with it. It's rated M. If you're under 18, you shouldn't be playing this game.
Correct.
That's so I don't want to hear any parents saying, oh, this game is too blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, that
you bought it for them. You know it's going to come up. It's going to be so stupid. So I can't wait till we get back on this podcast and be like, oh, those parents are stupid again. Because, you know, like, it is, if you go to a pornography website and it says you have to be 18 and up, you have to be 18 and up to see this stuff.
Yeah, don't get
that's what's going on
mad
with
at the creators for creating a thing for a certain demographic, and then the demographic who it's not for are, you know, game stores do adhere to that law that you have to be an adult to buy an M-rated game. Like, I've had to show ID back in the day to buy certain games. So these kids aren't just getting these games without the parent just buying it. It's just the parents aren't. They're not paying attention. And then they go back and blame somebody else.
And they might argue, oh, they're just buying it online. And they, you know, even online it says you got to be 18 and up. So if your kid is lying.
Yeah, and how is your kid, your like, if your kid is under 18, how are they buying anything online? Did you give them a credit card? Did you give them a debit card?
you can have a debit card when you're under 18. You know, I had a job when I was 15. You know what I'm saying?
Where were you working?
I was working at a public pool. This is a nice little side story.
Was this in Kingston?
No, this was in Reseda in Southern California.
Mm-hmm. This is not nice. Jamaica.
Yeah. No, not nice. It was a pool, a public pool. it was nice people. But, you know, I made my money and I spent it on video games when I wanted to. But I never, you know, bought something that was above my age limit, you know? And very rarely my mom would say, okay, you guys could do this, but while I'm in the room or something like that, you know? So if people are mad about this, it sucks to be you. That's how I feel. But I think it's going to be good. I think it's going to add to the game. It's going to add to the immersion. This game is supposed to be pretty crazy on the player. I'm hearing like a lot of, you got to decide how much humanity you want left when you're augmenting yourself and stuff like that. So I'm excited to see where it goes. I don't have a problem.
So aside from the potential controversy of just saying that we're going to do a fully motion captured sex scene in a game.
I'm
kind of the mindset that most sex scenes in general are kind of wholly unnecessary.
Okay.
Like, I find it rare that a sex scene in like a movie, a TV show, or a game adds anything of value. Remember Blue, you talked about implied action in anime before?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like that actually works in a story when you imply sex. Because you don't lose the time of the movie, you don't slow down the pace by just showing two people in love or having sex. Like, because to me, like, watching the physical connection for an extended period of time, like, it doesn't do anything. Like, whatever their chemistry is before that is what gives me the sense that these characters are in love with each other. You know what I mean?
I feel like someone could argue the same about a fight scene. Like, this fight scene's going on too long. I don't need to see the hate between them. They could just imply it, and one guy comes out with a bloody nose.
Well, that's fair. But in a fight, you're also viewing their skill. Cause like
in sex, you're also viewing their skill. I'm just saying, if the dude is awkward, it's going to add...
So in an instance like that, that serves a purpose. You're telling a story as part of the sex scene by showing them be awkward in bed. You know what I mean? Like, that's fine. But I'm talking about where it's like, okay, they're in love. Now let's just show them having sex.
You're showing that connection, that deep physical connection.
But at the same time, you could just fast forward to the morning after where they're having it, because they'll do it anyway. Like, they'll show them have the sex scene, and then they'll show them laying in bed together talking and stuff. You know what I mean? So you would still get this same exact effect if you just skipped the part where they're showing a dude move up and down on top of a girl or vice versa. You know what I mean?
I'll bring you back to the fight scene then. Mm-hmm. All right? So if someone's skilled at a fight scene, or they do average, you know, why do we show the whole thing? It is the same thing with the sex scene. If they're doing average or they're skilled or they're suck, whatever, they're showing the whole thing, right? Then there's always going to be a talk after a fight, whether someone's dead or not. They show that. You know what I mean? I think it serves for immersion. It serves to show the details of that relationship.
I mean, I guess if that's what you're invested in, like the relationship portion, then I guess that's... That scene, I guess, serves as what, like, the payoff?
Yeah.
Because to me, I just find the...
Or it could be betrayal, depending on what's going on, you know what I mean?
I don't know. I find, like, the dialogue portion or, like, their chemistry before that so much more interesting than watching movie sex.
I feel
that's,
you.
That's
I
just
feel
me.
You. Yeah, yeah.
Chow feel.
But anyhow, anything else on the Cyberpunk stuff, or?
I want to play this game. Like, I'm getting more and more interested in it, and not just because of this recent article, but just seeing some little reviews here and there. And these, this article definitely helped. Don't get me wrong. But I've just been seeing, you know, little news leaking out about the gameplay and story and what you
can. I like the customization. Looks really.
Mm-hmm. And you know, that's one of my biggest things. I love putting myself into a game. That's, you know, that immersion kind of deal. So I'm excited to play this game when it comes out. Hopefully we'll get it right away and be able to stream it and share it with our viewers.
True.
Yeah.
So we're going to move on to possible, well, not spoilers because this game hasn't actually even been announced, but apparently there's been some Fable 4 concept art that may have leaked online. Like, it was immediately pulled from where it was posted, like, mere hours after this thing went live. But, of course, the internet, nothing disappears on the internet. Folks caught it.
Oh, and, yeah. And
I don't know if you guys have taken a look at it. But it appears to be, like, this kind of pirate-y, Assassin's Creed-looking woman. And she looks very much, it looks like an Assassin's Creed character, to be honest.
Yeah. No, you're right.
But it's like the first thing we've seen of anything Fable related. And if you remember, the art in Fable is kind of a little cartoony, like slightly cartoony.
World of Warcraft.
Yeah. This art doesn't give me that feeling, like, which gives me hope that maybe they're going for a new look for like a new Fable, which I'd be okay with, because I never really liked that kind of whimsical look of the old ones. Like, what do you guys think about what leaked out?
The new look is close to Breath of the Wild, in my opinion. Close. It's not as cel-shaded, but it's close to it. And I like it. I want to... Man, I feel like I say this a lot. I want to see where this goes, right? But Fable is, you know, one of my favorite series. I hated the third one, like most people did. I still played through it. But, you know, the big moral choice, the good or bad or in between, is always fun. Jeff, what were you going to say? I'm sorry.
Oh, no, you're good.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So this Fable 4, I'd love to see it. I was just talking to my girl about, we're going through Game Pass, and we saw all three Fables on there, and she's like, yeah, I think I'm going to play them again. Maybe not the third one, but the first one is like...
I mean, you could play, like, the third one up to, like, that desert section, and then maybe just stop.
Just stop after that.
Yeah, that gives a huge disappointment.
4 would be great. I know a lot of people that's been waiting on 4.
Yeah, I mean, I love Fable from the first one. The first one was amazing.
Yeah.
Second one, I played over and over again. I don't know how many times I've gone back and played it. Like, just like 2 years ago, I went back and played it again. Third one was rough. I mean, it had some good points. I did like the choices you make.
It was more action-based.
Like, yeah.
When you become the king, right?
Yeah, when you have to decide what promises you keep. But for me, it was kind of anticlimactic because I kept all my promises. But then they was like, oh, well, if you go and find this diamond, it'll help replenish everything you just spent. So there was an answer to it. So I went and found the diamond, and I replenished the stocks for all the gold we spent keeping all the promises we made. And then you would think that people would understand, hey, we got a war coming. I made these promises, and as soon as this war is over, I'm going to keep up those promises. You know, otherwise I can keep these promises and all you guys are dead. Things were hit or miss, like the mixing of the magic. I think that was a miss that they really didn't work on too well. The way the weapons were supposed to evolve from the way you used them or whatever.
Yeah.
That was a dropped ball on that. I mean, I would love to see a Fable 4.
What do you think Fable 4 should do to basically kind of fix most of those problems?
This should be a reboot. I think this should be something that starts over, okay? I mean,
did the other story games, like, continue? Or were they, like, different characters?
They were different characters, but, like...
It always felt like it continued, though.
The Lady Teresa was the sister in the first one.
You're right, yeah.
So she was, like, the ongoing...
character, you know, that was,
yeah,
like...
exactly.
Hmm.
That was, you know, came back from each one. But I wouldn't mind seeing a new art style. Something open world. I want to see open world. I don't want to see...
Yeah, because they were, like, sectioned off before, right? Like, you're, like, being a big space, and then you have to go and travel, and then it's a loading screen. Yeah, they probably have the capacity at this point to make it, like, just one big landmass.
One of the things I loved about one of my favorite video games, Saints Row 2... is that it was open world and you could take over territories by doing specific missions, and those territories help generate income, you generate followers, blah, blah, blah. If they did something like that with Fable, I think that would be amazing.
I would love to see a some of the stuff they did was good. I would love to see, you know, some more customization. Of course. I'd love to see more of an effect of the deeds you make kind of determines how your character looks change. That mm-hmm. was a good thing in the game, where if you're yeah. good, if you're bad,
you had all the butterflies, you was going. Yes. Yeah, that was cool, man.
Also, I want to see more NPCs. I mean, there weren't a lot of NPCs in Fable. I want to see more NPCs. I want to see more of a multiplayer aspect to it, too.
They tried in the third one.
Yeah, they did like a weird co-op thing before, right?
You could play as a random thug. Like, you played, I mean, you had your abilities, but in that person's world, you weren't your character. You were just a thug or some shit like that. Or something like that. Excuse me.
But you, so if your character was in someone else's world, they saw you as a thug, but you saw yourself as you.
You.
And they looked like a thug. It was not cool. It's like, oh, look at all this armor I did. Not really. You just look like some random dude.
Because if you don't remember, they were working on Fable Heroes, where you played with a five-person game. Four people were the good guys whatever heroes they picked.
Like a dungeon master.
Exactly, and kind of put pitfalls and bosses and traps in your way.
That was like an early announcement, and then that basically got scrapped.
Yeah.
It would have been cool, man.
I don't know, because Evolve was sort of like that, like the asymmetrical multiplayer, where it's like there's a team on this side and then another person on that side, and that pretty much, feel like that didn't become a thing that people liked until like the Dead by Daylight type games, which was like years and years into the generation. So I don't think Fable would have kind of changed that early on.
But I think like being more of a dungeon master, so trying to drive a story versus trying to be the main antagonist and kill everybody, they're a little different. You know what I'm saying? But I don't know if that's exactly the path that Fable Heroes was trying to go down. I'd like to make a game that's challenging for my friends, but I don't want to destroy all their characters.
I do.
I don't. In Evolve and Dead by Daylight, you're trying to kill everybody. So I do feel the, or even Hello Neighbor that we've been playing too. You know,
secret neighbor. Yeah.
Creepy neighbor.
Creepy neighbor. Clown neighbor.
But Fable 4, if they do make it now, I'd be excited to play it. And hopefully, you know, there's not as much controversy behind it of what the game is going to be able to do versus what the game will actually be able to do. So
wouldn't be behind it at this point.
Yeah.
And it's known to just kind of make outlandish promises that don't come to fruition.
Every game comes with a golden goose who can poop golden eggs. Like,
what the heck?
It's like, okay.
Well, I do want to say,
yeah.
Do you think that, because I would like a more robust multiplayer aspect, even if it's, you know, a kind of a single player based RPG, do you think that would kind of hurt Fable, which is traditionally kind of a single player game? Like if you were able to play through the whole story with like a co-op partner or like multiple people in an open world or something?
No, for me it would have to be, you know, it would be amazing, and this is just.
Outlandish.
Fable MMO.
I was thinking the same exact thing.
I kind of wouldn't want to play that, to be honest.
I understand. KC doesn't like MMOs.
That's not true. That's not true at all. Like,
Name one. Name one that
you
like.
Fantasy Star wouldn't count as an MMO, I guess, right?
How long ago was that?
It doesn't matter. If they made a Pokemon MMO, I'd be there day one. If they made a Monster Hunter World MMO, I'd be there day one. Like, it depends kind of on the setting. I'm not a fan of the fantasy setting. Like, there are certain fantasy things that I will see past the setting and get into. For example, like the Dragon Prince on Netflix. Watch that show. It's fantasy, it's elves, it's magic, but it's freaking amazing. It's a great story. Like, I'm sucked all the way in.
My eyes hurt when I watch that.
It doesn't look that bad, and you get used to it afterwards. It's...
You know what I'm saying?
To be honest,
B2K.
It gets better in season two. So, like, it is a little rougher season one. That animation looks better season two onward. But the story is dope.
Did I see MMO you're going with? Dragon Prince?
Yes. Okay. I haven't played Dragon Prince MMO.
But, oh my gosh.
But yeah, it's just it's just not my thing, the fantasy setting. But
yeah, but I get you. Multiplayer would add a more layers to the game. If they did it kind of the way Borderlands does their multiplayer, where you could go to the story together, you can pop it and out together.
Yeah, stuff yeah, like I think that that would be cool. That kind of yeah, I would like that. But we're gonna move on from Fable.
Yeah.
Let's talk about more future things. Xbox Scarlet, the code name for the next Xbox console. Apparently, Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox, stated that they're not going to be focusing on VR, mainly because nobody's asking for it. How do you guys feel about this statement?
We just talked about this when we were talking about the new Half-Life coming out. And we were saying that you know maybe the new consoles. For me, I don't really care much about VR. Maybe because I haven't gotten into it. I haven't tried it. But, I mean, we've tried it at the cafe at the meetup.
Yeah.
In D.C.
Now, if I played something that was an amazing game and it was immersive or whatever it is, great. But when I turn on my Xbox, I don't...
want to put on a headset.
Yeah, or I don't think about playing VR. I haven't, you know, like, oh, you know, I'm going to go home and play some VR. Or I need to get a VR system. For me, those are the feelings that tell me that's something I'm going to be interested in.
Right.
Up until I get the experience, that's going to change my mind. So for me, it not having it doesn't really affect anything for me.
Okay, so
until they get that dive gear and we all start out online, yo, day one, baby, you and me, Jeff, let's go.
Going in, laughing, coughing.
So, Blue, do you agree that you're not really asking for VR at this point?
Yeah, no, unfortunately, I want to. It's the weirdest thing. I want good VR games. But I'm not willing to try the stuff right now,
right?
Because it's too much, it's too much of an investment, and it hasn't paid off for anybody, in my opinion, yet. So I'm gonna wait till we continue this technological advancement that we're on, and we get maybe another sense. Honestly, so we got sound and hearing. Sound and hearing, duh. Sound and sight. Sound and sight, right? Those are two senses that are stimulated. And you can even say touch, right, with the rumble in the controller.
Mm-hmm.
If we get one more sense, and I'm not saying I want to
smell it now.
I don't necessarily want to taste nothing, but if we get more hepatic feedback, I think that's the word, more touch, or even smells, then you're talking about immersion. And the reason why I say that, right? You guys know I was in the Navy. I did deployment back in 2015, and I went overseas. One of the places we stopped in is Singapore, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I always say you can Google Singapore, and you can watch videos, and you can know everything about it. But you'll never really experience it till you smell that place. And I'm not saying it's a bad smell.
Okay.
I'm saying that it's different, right?
Okay.
It's pungent, and it really shapes that area. And
so it's like burned into your brain, the smell of Singapore.
Yeah. Yeah, it really is. And that's, you know, that's another thing about experiencing a new place. So even smell would be an upgrade for VR.
What about
you get I'm not hit, tasting that thing.
You get electrocuted, you get a little shock.
That's scary. No, that's scary.
Yeah, that's
you know, boom. My one friend with the heart problem.
No, we're gonna have them death battles. Let's go.
Death battles.
You die in a game, you die in real life.
Get a little shock.
I'd be way too nervous.
they have those kind of things where it's like a vest or something, and it's like it's feedback in the vest, like rumbles or like
I've seen those.
Yeah, but I don't know how useful that is.
No, you gotta have electric current.
He's trying to kill people.
Not at high voltage.
You have to do it
very low
in your bathtub. Jeff trying to kill us, yo.
Oh my gosh.
Play a swimming game. Get your VR.
The bathroom, like, two more laps.
But yeah, honestly, I have to agree with Phil Spencer is that, yeah, it doesn't seem like it's like a wanted thing, especially not in the Xbox community. Like, I can't think offhand of anybody who's like really clamoring for Xbox to jump into this field. Like maybe earlier on, like when VR was kind of more new, like, well, this new kind of VR with like the Vive coming out and the Oculus coming out and stuff. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. PlayStation was announcing that they were getting into VR. You kind of wanted Xbox to also do it because you want to push the technology. You want it to get better and stuff. And Xbox kind of took a back seat. They didn't feel like it was necessary. And honestly, it was probably better for them to not focus on that because they were kind of in third last place and not doing well in terms of sales and blah, blah, blah. In comparison to the other companies, PlayStation kind of had the wiggle room to do more experimentation. And they had some cool experiences on their VR device, apparently. Like Tetris Effect, apparently was a really, really cool way to play Tetris. Like, it was nominated for some people's Game of the Year, even. Like, a new Tetris game because of the VR aspect. That game, Astrobot, apparently was doing, like, some really cool platforming type stuff in the VR world. Okay. So, like, those are experiences that I do want to try. But, yeah, I'm kind of not in the market to spend that money on it just yet. Like,
and that's like, what I was thinking about. Like that vest that you're talking about. I'm not spending $80 to put on the equivalent of a bulletproof vest to play a video game to get hit with.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Like it's not enough, you know?
It's not.
So maybe, like Jeff was saying, with Half-Life Alyx coming out, like you can't even use like the regular VR setup for that. You need to use the Index, which are I think the finger reading gloves, you know, or I don't know what that controller is. It's like a weird contraption that goes over your hands.
Power glove.
Yeah, and if apparently the Indexes are selling out now. That game was announced. People was like, "Oh, I'm excited. I want to try it now." So maybe that will push it forward. Like if it becomes such a big thing. There's plenty of time for Xbox to get into it later if it becomes a thing that the fan base really wants, you know?
And do it right.
Right, yeah. Because PlayStation VR, it was kind of an experiment. Like, people liked it. I think it sold fairly okay.
Yeah.
There were a lot of problems with it. Like, the cabling, I hear, was an issue. They eventually did, like, a newer version that kind of got rid of some of that. But, it's not super powerful either. Like, in comparison to all the other ones, the ones that connect to your PC, the PlayStation VR is, like, a very weak version of VR. So it can't even run some of the other games that kind of have come out for the Vive or the Oculus.
Yeah.
So, I want to see VR get better. Like, I do think it is a future technology to be used for video games as much as well as all sorts of stuff, like, kind of just productivity in general. I think we're going to see a lot of applications come out in VR, but you know what, it's fine if Xbox lets other companies kind of do that work and then they just jump on the bandwagon after the fact, like as long as somebody's doing it, you know what I mean? Like Valve is pushing it with the Vive, so I do think that it's not going anywhere anytime soon, so that's all that matters to me.
I feel you.
So that's gonna do it for the VR talk.
Mm-hmm.
And our last topic for this show, we're going to talk about the Game Awards, the Video Game Awards nominees. So they've just been announced. They're all up on the website. There are a lot of nominees in a bunch of categories. I'm going to ignore, forgive me, all of the esports stuff. Because there's like five or six different categories just dedicated to esports coach, esports player, esports this, that, and the third. Not all that interested in that. But we are going to talk about some of the main games that are getting some award nods.
Can I say something about esports real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
Real quick. One of the things they had was esports event of the year, and Evo 2019 was on there, and I have to give a shout out to Sonic Fox, because he made that event live. So hopefully that one wins. But all right, that's all I got to say about esports. That's my dude.
All right, we're gonna go down, if you guys are looking at the website,
okay,
to audio design and then go upwards.
I see what you're saying. It's okay, like
or six categories. So we'll just real quick go through like what's been nominated and what you guys think. Of course, we haven't played all of these games, but
yeah,
we are.
I've probably played them all.
Sure.
Psych.
So for audio design, recognizing the best in-game audio and sound design, they have Call of Duty Modern Warfare, They have Control, mm-hmm. they have Death Stranding, they have Gears 5, they have Resident Evil 2 Remake, and then they have Sekiro Shadows Die Twice. So, what are your guys' favorites out of this list so far?
So now, go ahead, Jeff, you got it?
So, I'm going to say, for me, it's going to be Sekiro.
For audio design.
It's going to be, yep, it's going to be...
What about the audio kind of stands out to you in Sekiro?
For me, it's the enemies talking. A lot of the music that's playing in the areas that you're in actually kind of flows for me. It feels good. It immerses you in the game. Mm-hmm. And the combat sounds, like the guy with the cannon arm, like it actually sounds like he's shooting a cannon from his arm. It's not just like...
I need you on my next Foley team, bro.
Obviously, there's Gears 5 for me. I think the audio in there is amazing, from the Lancer chainsaw to Marcus talking to the locust coming out the ground to the new enemies, the noises that they make. They're all unique to those particular enemies. And then Call of Duty as well has always had like really good audio, from explosions to machine gun fire to pistol fire to the dialogue and the stories when you're playing through the story mode. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like, goes to Captain Pierce was always like just like that guy, like like the way he talked, the way he carried his voice, the way the ending of I think that was 4 when he showed up and he hung the guy from the you fell through the roof and you hung the guy or something by a rope or something, and then Pierce showed up and killed him.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I remember this.
From the glass falling. The glass was falling. It actually sounded like glass falling. Like you.
But I mean, to be fair, we are talking about this particular Call
of Duty. The latest word.
Yeah.
I was just giving examples. I haven't played the latest one. But I was just saying, you know, that Call of Duty has always been, you know, on that level. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Now, I am not the biggest Call of Duty fan by any means, but I have watched a couple streams of this latest one, and I must say the gunfire sounds crazy accurate. And for some reason, that's been a hard thing to do in video games. I don't know the logistics of it, but
do they not record like actual guns?
It sounds like that's the easy way to do it, right?
they must do that, because I'm pretty sure that's what, the auto, racing game developers do. Like, they get mics, like, right underneath the exhaust and the engine and all that stuff. So they must do the same thing for weapons. I just haven't seen that done
myself. So I think the thing is, with a lot of guns and a lot of fire, it's louder than, if you only play video games, it's louder than you expect. Right. And I think that's what happened. They just turned it up. I think they just turned it up in Call of Duty, and it works. It's hard for me to watch it as a veteran because it sounds so real, you know.
So, I mean, that's the testament,
and I'll give props to that. I'll give props to that.
For me, out of these, I've only played Sekiro and Gears 5. Mm-hmm. Control is on my computer, but I haven't started it yet. So I don't know, because honestly, I don't like, I'm familiar with the sounds of Gears, mm-hmm. like for playing the series for so long, but nothing about the Gears 5's audio design in particular kind of stands out to me. So for these other games that are nominated that I know probably paid a lot more attention, like maybe like even Death Stranding in this instance, because I know Kojima, like he very heavily curates the soundtrack in terms of like songs that play, and you know, all these performances from all the voice actors and stuff. Like, I don't know, I think that might kind of have the edge here in audio design. And again, like Sekiro, like Jeff bringing up like the sound of like the enemies and stuff, that wasn't stuff that stuck with me either in that game. Like I was maybe a bit more immersed with just the feel of the game mechanics. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I really couldn't say. And I haven't played Death Stranding, but to me, that seems like the favorite in my head. Probably between Death Stranding and Control would be my guess to kind of come out on top with that. But art direction. This is an interesting one.
Yeah.
Outstanding creative and or technical achievement in artistic design and animation. We have, again, Control. Again, Death Stranding. We have Grease, which is a indie game.
Mm-hmm.
Sayonara Wild Hearts, which is another indie game that was on Apple Arcade.
Yeah.
Again, Sekiro, Shadows Die Twice. And then The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening, the remake. Mm. I'll go first for this one.
Okay.
I have not played Grease because, one, that game reviewed poorly in terms of, like, actual gameplay. Like, it's not a game that has a lot of actual game mechanics in it. But the look of that game is unlike anything. Like, you can just watch a bit of that game, and it looks amazing. Like, just straight up painting.
You can go ahead and skip me, because that's exactly what I was going to say.
Right.
Honestly, that game is living art.
Yeah, it really looks like something else. Like, kind of the entirety of that game's appeal is kind of his art style.
Hmm. Yeah.
I'll have to have a look at that.
Yeah, definitely take a look if you haven't. Like, see what... It is spelled G-R-I-S, but it's pronounced like mm-hmm. Greece.
I guess...
the one that I want.
In my opinion, I think, like you said, Death Stranding has the advantage in this one. I mean, I haven't played it, but it does look beautiful.
Right,
it does look...
Graphically, like, yeah.
Yeah, it does look like... You know, the characters, the terrain, the babies, the little Tamagotchis, they look very, like, detailed. So,
babies.
And then even from the little ghost that they showed. And then I finally saw the trailer where it showed, like, some bad guys, like the dudes in the military outfits and stuff like that. And that looked very, very, very well detailed. So I think for me, this is going to have the edge as far as visually.
Mm-hmm.
And I also want to shout out Sayonara Wild Hearts. I actually played a little bit of it. I don't think I talked about it because I played, I want to say, 20 minutes at most. Like, okay. It's a rhythm game. It's like very, like, you know how Windows Media Player used to have, like, the equalizer? You would play music and it would, like,
flash all the visualizations?
Stuff. Yeah, it's kind of like that. Cool. But it's also kind of trippy. It's like a big music video with, like, pop music in the background. I really didn't like it. Like, it felt difficult to control because honestly all the controllers do is like those endless runners where like, or like Temple Run where you're like, you just move the character left and right. That's kind of what you're doing mixed in with like
rhythm
quick time
stuff.
Events, yeah, like rhythm based okay. quick time events and stuff, and it's just kind of showing you a bunch of stuff happening. There's like lights flashing, there's like the world is spinning, the characters are flying around, like that stuff is cool and all, but the gameplay matched with those visualizations, I felt like takes you out of it. Because, like, at least me, I was playing it on an iPad. And it was, like, my fingers were literally getting in the way of actually looking at what was going on in certain instances. And, like, you would have to repeat certain instances because, like, you would fail missions for the game not responding to you moving the character to the right. You're, like, crashing to a wall. Like, I really didn't like it. But the look is kind of like a cel-shaded-ish looking Breath of the Wild, but with like a lower polygon count.
Yeah, there's another game I used to play back in the day. It was on the Nintendo DS, and it was one of those
Elite Beat Agents.
No, I love Elite Beat Agents, but it's not that. I know this is, Elite Beat Agents is more detailed than that. But this was one where it wasn't a dating sim necessarily, but it was like a I'm gonna look it up. Y'all keep it going. Trust me, it's got a similar art style. It's like a minimalistic, and oh, it looks almost mocap. You know what I mean? But yeah, I'm gonna pull it up, and maybe you guys know what I'm talking about. But yeah, go ahead. What's our next subject? Yeah. We got action adventure game, right?
Yeah, action adventure. So for the best action adventure game, combining combat with traversal and puzzle solving, they have Borderlands 3, Control again, Death Stranding again, Resident Evil 2, The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening, and again, Sekiro Shadows Die Twice. I think Sekiro might be my favorite for this particular category. And again, I haven't played Control. I haven't played Borderlands 3. I hesitate to call Resident Evil 2 an action-adventure game, to be honest. Isn't that more of a survival horror?
For me, it is.
Resident Evil 2, yeah. I mean, survival horror adventure. It's an adventure going on. There's action. I don't think they're all exclusive.
I mean, I guess since there's no, it doesn't seem like there's like a separate like horror category, right?
Yeah. No, there's not.
So I guess that's where you would slot it in if you wanted to give it accolades. But kind of against everything else here, well, at least against, to me, against Control from what I've been hearing about it, and then Sekiro, I can't imagine Resident Evil coming out on top.
Yeah, no, definitely. My choice on this one, I've actually heard relatively, I'd say like 60-40 bad reviews for Borderlands 3.
Really?
Yeah. And
I've heard 99-1.
Bad reviews?
99-1 what? Like, is that
99 good reviews and one bad
review. Oh, good. Okay. All right, that's good then.
No,
so,
it's the truth.
I'm glad we got different circles to kind of pull from.
you need to check your circle.
I need to check my circle. I think my circle's fine.
Don't check anybody's circles, man. This isn't that kind of shit.
Y'all nasty. So, when it comes to active adventure, I haven't played Death Stranding, but I heard it's one big delivery mission.
Yeah, so where's the action, essentially?
You know what I mean? And when I watch these streams and I watch the videos on the gameplay, I don't see much action that you're doing. I see a lot of getting chased, and I see a lot of falling down hills, and that's, you know, that's something. But I don't know how much interaction actually really happens there. Sekiro, I have seen. I've seen the strategy. I've seen the story.
I've seen the bulls with the horns.
You know what I'm saying? I've seen the stress in the players' faces. I give it to Sekiro this time around.
I personally do think it's going to be a toss-up between Sekiro and Control.
Yeah.
But I just haven't gotten the chance to play Control yet. You know what? I'm going to try to start it.
Yeah, start it today. And yeah. Then send me the file with the video of you playing so I can watch it.
Okay, so the game I was thinking about earlier was called The Rub Rabbits on Nintendo DS.
Oh.
Do you remember that?
Is. Yes.
Yeah, it's got a similar art style. Now I'm looking back at it, it's not exactly what I thought, but it's very close. And yeah, that's all I'm going to say about that
game. The Rub Rabbits?
Yeah.
Rub Rabbits.
Just leave it at that.
I think we got our title.
I did.
Rub Rabbits.
Anyhow.
You ain't nothing but a rub rabbit.
So this is interesting. I'm really trying to push past this. It's interesting that this category was action adventure game, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the next one is
action
game.
Pure action.
So what's the difference between these two categories, and why?
Let's look at how they described it. So this is action adventure again, for the. Combining combat with traversal and puzzle solving. Okay? Action game is for the best game in action genre focused primarily on combat. So,
okay.
A bit of a distinction.
Okay. I guess I would assume the first one should be just adventure game, and then this one should be action game.
Well,
but I get
because adventure games is a whole other genre too. Like, there are adventure games that focus only on traversal or puzzle solving or story, you know? Yeah, and not combat. So I understand why there's an action/adventure, because like they combine those two separate things. But this doesn't have like an adventure game category.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the thing. There's a lot of games I feel are kind of left out.
Yeah, but like genres in general have kind of all really begun to bleed together for the most part. So distinguishing them like the way we've done in the past has become a lot harder than it used to be.
Yeah.
But let's don't necessarily get a lot of horror. This year's actually been a lot of horror games. There was the Blair Witch Project.
What was that? World War Z?
World War Z.
And that's like a survival.
Yeah, that's
action.
That's more of an action.
Yeah. And
I got scared.
I'm sure.
Wow.
But what were the nominations
Nominees for action game are Apex Legends, which I forget came out this year. Like, geez.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Astral Chain, Call of Duty Modern Warfare, Devil May Cry 5, which I also forgot came out this year, Gears 5, and Metro Exodus, which is like an open world thing. I'm like, how is that not an adventure game, like an action adventure game? That's weird to me that that's in here.
You see what I'm saying?
But what are you guys' favorites in the action game lineup?
Well, for me, Astro Train looks amazing. Haven't played it yet. Plan to play it in the future at some point. What was the first one again?
Apex Legends.
Yes, Apex Legends. I mean, that was really fun. I mean, it still is a really fun game. It just, so much things I was playing, I kind of fell off from playing it. But it, especially for a free-to-play game, it was amazing. I mean, even if you paid for the game, it was actually pretty good.
It's solid, you know, either way, yeah.
Yeah. So, for me, it's going to be between those two, I would think.
Between Astro Chain and Apex Legends, yeah. I think? Okay.
Yeah.
What are your favorites looking like?
Apex Legends gets it for me, hands down. It came out with the bang. It has disappointed me once.
With the bang.
You know what I'm saying? Like, for real, the way it came out was just amazing.
Like, hey, surprise, here's this.
Here's an amazing game right off the bat. Everybody can play it. You know what I mean?
True.
And they're constantly updating it. They're tweaking it. They're balancing it. Apex Legends, you get it. For me,
Apex Legends.
Yeah, I kind of I agree. Like, I do think Apex Legends is probably my favorite for this genre, for this category rather. Kind of because of the huge impact it had when it launched. Like, it got a bunch of people who were kind of like, I don't want anything to do with a battle royale genre to understand how a battle royale genre can be fun.
This guy right here,
right, and it was kind of cool. Respawn's like redemption story. Well, not, yeah, because not to say that, like, Respawn has always been a quality developer. Like, they made Titanfall 1, which was very well critically received, but didn't sell very well. And then they made Titanfall 2. Well, no, actually, Titanfall 1 sold very well, but then the critics kind of went soft on it because it didn't have anything after the multiplayer thing. It was all multiplayer focused. It was no real story. Titanfall 2 addressed that, was critically acclaimed, but then didn't sell very well because I guess the players of the first game felt like they were, like, it had a sharp drop off in terms of, like, players. So this kind of brought Respawn back from the dead. Not dead. They weren't dead, but it kind of put them in the limelight. And they're continuing that path with Star Wars, because that was from them too. Also this year. So that's very impressive. So I would want them to win this to kind of keep their streak going.
I wonder what the cutoff is for this stuff, because I would have thought Star Wars would be on one of these lists.
Yeah, I think probably the voting and stuff would have been done before that game released. Yeah.
Yeah, so this is probably part of next year.
Right.
It better be. It better be. This game is great. Go ahead. What's your question, bro?
What's next?
What's next?
Anyway, Game of the Year is next.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, matter of fact, before we go to Game of the Year, I forgot. Deep
Did
down,
you scroll down.
Yeah, they have
family.
Not family. Do you guys want to talk about family? Because I was looking for fighting game.
Yeah, fighting game too. I see it.
So they have in the fighting game category. I'll read the description for the best game designed primarily around head-to-head combat. They have Dead or Alive 6, which I had no idea came out this year. Jump Force, which I think should not be on this list.
Don't hate.
It's visually stunning.
That has nothing
to
do with it being fighting game, best fighting game of the year. I disagree. It's not visually stunning at all to me. And then Mortal Kombat 11, Samurai Showdown, and then Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, which made the fighting game list. There's no denying Super Smash Bros. Is a fighting game. The FGC, the fighting game community, likes to try and push it to the side, like, oh, it's not a real fighting game. It's for babies. It's blah, blah, blah.
Who says that?
The fighting game community. The folks who laugh at the fact that Terry Bogard's regular button inputs are in the game.
I think Super Smash Bros. Has its hands down. But I did enjoy visually Jump Force. Not technically, like, not the mechanics-wise. And then Mortal Kombat 11, I think it's a very close second for me. Only because they took out some mechanics from 10 that really changed up the game. One of the biggest things they changed is running. You cannot run in this game unless your character like special runs.
I feel like they go back and forth in Mortal Kombat with that. Like it's like every other game you can run in it.
Yeah, and in 10 I thought they did an amazing job with it, and I wanted it to stay. No, they took it out again, so it's like, man. And it's huge, you know, when it comes to the overall mechanics. So I still say Super Smash Bros. Takes it.
As big of a Smash Bros. Fan as I am, I kind of see Mortal Kombat 11 coming out on top, to be honest. Like, I feel like it's more traditional. A close second. And mm-hmm. I feel like the kind of judges who would, like, gather and be on that panel, like, just, like, Smash just getting the nomination, I feel like in their heads would be enough. But they wouldn't, like, desecrate the fighting game genre by making it the best fighting game of the year. Like, they would want to give it to something that has more lineage. That's a factor. Yeah, like, I mean, it's there are actual industry people who are voting in this, so I'm kind of taking that into consideration. I can't imagine, I don't know how the hell Jump Force got on this list, to be honest. Last thing,
I'm feel trying like to ignore that slander. There's a lot of salt in your blood for a game you haven't given a fair shake to.
How did I not give it a fair shake? I played it for a significant amount of time. I did the tutorials.
And did you fight other people?
Did I? Did I fight one of you guys?
That's where we had the most fun, was fighting each other.
But, I mean, you could have fun playing whatever with a friend. Like, it doesn't make the thing that you guys were playing any better or worse.
True. No, I feel what Sig was saying.
No, you don't.
So we'll wait till Jeff tells us the rest of our feelings. So, Jeff, do you have a pick then? For what you think?
It's kind of the same, too. Mortal Kombat and Smash. Those are the two that I think are top two contenders for that particular category.
One thing I'll say about those two games, Mortal Kombat 11 had a much better story than Super Smash Bros. That story was actually really good.
Can you even call Super Smash Bros. Ultimate a story?
I'm just saying.
It's kind of a included events.
There's a story mode that was included.
Right.
Right? And you had fighting mechanics throughout it. And the same with Mortal Kombat 11. There's story mode, and you had fighting mechanics throughout. Mortal Kombat 11 was better than Super Smash Bros.
Yeah, I would agree with that. All right, so we're going to move off of the fighting games category and move into the RPG or role-playing game category for the best game designed with rich player character customization and progression, including massively multiplayer experiences. They have Disco Elysium, which is a fairly new game, Final Fantasy XIV, Kingdom Hearts 3, Monster Hunter World Iceborne, and The Outer Worlds. Mm. So I can probably guess what Blue would pick for role playing game.
Of course,
here.
Disco Elysium, baby.
All right.
You know, I stand by Final Fantasy 14. It's such an amazing game. It's come so far, and the developers and the game directors really, I feel like they listen to the fans. They balance everything for good. And while people are upset with changes every time, they end up accepting it and realizing why things were changed. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I think generally I'm not gonna say there's not toxic people on there, but it's a good community in general. Like, you have a small percentage of toxic folks, and
it's
gameplay
constantly just evolving and stuff, right?
What's that?
Like keep adding stuff to the game essentially, right? Like
they keep adding stuff out.
One or two expansions within this year, or was it more than that?
This year it's been one. Yeah, but they're still releasing major patches, you know, to address issues that come up. And they do it fairly quickly, too. You feel the love in this game. And it's a game that you don't really want to stop playing, even once you've finished the story. There's so much to do. And there's so much to get into, and there's so much to master in the game. And it's Final Fantasy. The music and, you know, the art direction, you know it's amazing. So they got it from me. I love Iceborne, Monster Hunter Iceborne. I love The Outer Worlds. Kingdom Hearts 3, I like it. I don't love it. But Final Fantasy still wins by a mile for me.
Okay. Me, personally.
Yeah.
I haven't played any other RPG on this list other than Monster Hunter World Iceborne. But I will say, I don't think it'll win. Like, if I have to pick, like, based on kind of what I'm hearing from, like, the community, it's either going to be between The Outer Worlds or Disco Elysium. Because I actually have Disco Elysium on my computer, because of what I've heard. Like, IGN, I believe, gave it a 10 this year. I think that's the only 10 they've given. And the guys from Escapist who played that game, like, they're on it. Like, apparently it's, like, a very, very immersive, mostly story-driven, but, like, in-depth role-playing game, like, with a capital RPG. Like, you build a character, like, you give them traits and stuff, and the way they respond to things is, like, very, very unique based on kind of their skill checks and, like, the way you've built them up and, like, talents and stuff that they have. It's not very combat heavy, but it's very, like, role playing centric. So
that makes me feel like it's another D&D. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I think it's kind of heavily based off of, like, the way those tabletop role playing games kind of function.
And I love D&D, don't get me wrong, but I don't feel like this. I don't know. I don't feel I haven't played it. A lot of people are saying it's great, but I don't feel like it's creative enough to be RPG of the year.
Well, you want to say a game like this isn't creative enough, yet Final Fantasy 14 is kind of a World of Warcraft clone, isn't it?
You could say that earlier on when it first started, but the way it is now, completely different. Completely different.
Okay, but I mean, the game is what, like 7-8 years old? How long has 14 been out?
Yeah, about 7-8 years. I could double check, but it's been out for a minute, or for about less than 10 years.
But you have actually played the Outer Worlds, which I think is the other favorite to win here. Like, how?
Yeah.
Like, in comparison to Final Fantasy 14, like, you're still head over heels for Final Fantasy 14.
Yeah, and I'm trying to keep my, you know, my long playtime aside. Yeah, my bias aside. Outer Worlds is great. I think it's kind of the Fallout for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Fallout that everybody can play. And I think that's why it's so widely received. I love the colors in there. I love the people that you talk to, the responses that you can get. And, you know, the same D&D build that you see in Disco Elysium. You can see that kind of, you know, the basic traits and skills. You see it here, too. So, I think that the Outer Worlds is easier to be received by the masses, and that's why it's up on that list.
I can see that. What about you, Jeff? Any opinion on a role-playing game?
So I would think it would be between Iceborne and Final Fantasy 14. I feel like Outer Worlds might be a contender because it's so fresh and new. It's good and it's fresh. It's going to be fresh in a lot of people's mind.
Right.
You know, so they would have just played it recently. I was like, oh, this is really good. As opposed to, you know, not to say Iceborne was that long ago, but Iceborne as well. You know what I mean? So it's, to me, it's up between Final Fantasy 14. And is it a particular DLC that's up for that, or is it just the entire game?
It's probably the Shadowbringers DLC.
Okay. That's the only way I think it would be able to be on this list, is because it had a release within this year. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and they kind of did a complete overhaul with that DLC, too.
Those are my two picks for this particular category.
I feel you.
Okay. So,
all right.
We're going to go to the last category here.
The big one.
The game of the year. We have... Let me read the description real quick. Recognizing a game that delivers the absolute best experience across all creative and technical fields. So, just the best of the best. We have Control, Death Stranding, Resident Evil 2, Sekiro, Shadows Die Twice, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, and The Outer Worlds. I just want to say, it's kind of sketchy.
Death Stranding on everything?
Yeah, it's kind of sketchy that Death Stranding was on so many different categories and is in Game of the Year, when one, the guy who runs the Game of the Year Awards, Jeff Keighley, has kind of this long-standing friendship, we'll call it, with Hideo Kojima, the Death Stranding's director, and is in the game. Like, they scan his face, and he's like a secret character, not a secret character, he's just a character in the game.
A cameo.
Yeah, he had a cameo in the game. And then it kind of just, like, the thing is, Death Stranding has had mixed reviews. There are outlets that have given it perfect scores.
Mm-hmm.
Some that have given it high scores. The Japanese magazine Famitsu has also given it a perfect score, but it's also under kind of sketchy circumstances because Hideo Kojima also put that game's previous owner in the game as a scanned character as well. So it's like the ethics of that kind of seem off. You know?
That sounds wrong, bro. It seems sketchy, man. Like, I don't feel like these judges and people involved in Game of the Year, these game nominations, Game Awards, should be involved in the production of these games at all. Because if I was in a game, I'd like that to be at least nominated for Game of the Year. No matter what it was. You know what I'm saying?
But it's just so weird because of how, like, if you've watched interviews with Jeff Keighley, like, a lot of the coverage about Death Stranding have been kind of fed through Jeff Keighley. Jeff Keighley. I keep saying Keighley. Jeff Keighley. Like, he's done, like, interviews. He's done in-depth things with Kojima. He toured the studio. He talked to him. Like, that's when the scan would happen. He was basically doing, like, a tour of his studio and talking to him, getting coverage for the game. Like, he's been kind of involved in the marketing of it. And then for his award show be sitting in the Game of the Year nominees, when it's not kind of a unanimous thing that the industry is in love with the game, you know what I mean? Like, some people are thinking it's highly of it. Other people, like, IGN gave it, what, a 6.5 or something?
Yeah, it was relatively low.
Mediocre on their scale. And some other, like, I can't remember off the top of my head, but some other outlets also were not very hot on it. So when you have, like, probably the number one outlet, and then several others, because I know GameSpot is probably the number two or something. They gave it like a 9. I don't know. I don't know how that ends up on the Game of the Year list when it's so divisive.
That's true. You figure it would be like unanimous across the board.
Right.
And it just came out.
Yeah, and it just came out. A pretty recent release, too. So
I don't know, man.
I don't know. That don't seems feel a little sketch.
I think Death Stranding's going to win.
Jeff Keighley would be hard-pressed to sell that, I think. Like, maybe getting it on the list is, like, the favor that he's doing.
As far as he can go.
Yeah, and if he were to let it win, then he'd probably have, like, a lot of questions to answer, maybe.
Now, was this remake of Resident Evil 2 that good?
Apparently so. Like, people have been in love with it, because, yeah, it's up here for Game of the Year. And I've never been, like, a big Resident Evil fan, so I would have to abstain from an opinion on that, but I would probably never pick Resident Evil as a Game of the Year contender.
right.
But I mean, out of everything else on here, I've played Sekiro, I've played Smash. I would probably lean towards Control over everything else on this list. I would personally pick Smash, but I don't think the rest of the industry would. Game of the Year.
I think it's between Control and Sekiro.
Control and Sekiro, you think?
Yeah.
I mean, to be honest, I'm actually surprised that Sekiro has made it onto so many different categories. Like, it's been nominated for, like, a bunch of stuff. And, like, I like that game a whole lot, but I don't remember it kind of having... I mean, immediately after release, sure, but, like, in the months after that, I don't feel like it's been continually coming back up in terms of conversation. But apparently a lot of people are still really high on it. So that's encouraging.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely got to play Control.
What do you think, Jeff?
I'm thinking critically probably Control because there's been a lot of buzz about it. I think Sekiro is really good game, but like once again, it came out a while ago, so the buzz on it isn't as new and as fresh as everything else. Smash Brothers, like you said, it's great that it's on there, but I doubt it would win Game of the Year.
Yeah,
I mean, it was a great accomplishment. All Smash Brothers characters.
Yeah, the game is amazing. It should win something.
Third party characters. So we'll see. I mean, I would like it to win, like you said. For me, it's between them and Sekiro. I would like to try Control and see what all the fuss is about. But critically, I think that has the most buzz about it.
Yeah, I'm going to try to start Control soon and report back.
Yeah, let me get your in-depth gameplay review. You can actually stream that.
Yeah.
Can I stream? Maybe. I'll double check. I probably can't stream that.
All right.
So that's our last topic of the day. Mm-hmm. We're not going to do a top three or any trivia this week. Sorry, guys. We just want to kind of keep the show to a manageable length in time. But if you have any questions and such that you want to ask us, definitely hit up the email. That's bbetgaming@gmail.com. Jeff, where can people find you?
So you can find me on Facebook at SupermanJeff12Plays, or you can find me on Mixer at SupermanJeff12.
Blue, where can people find you?
It's your boy, Blue, BLUB0NES. Find me on Twitter, that same handle. You can find me on Mixer, BlueBonesXB, as in Xbox, Wakanda Forever. Also, guys, tune into our Super Smash Sundays. We didn't do a review this time around, a recap, but last week was pretty explosive. It was a lot of fun. We had some, especially for Mr. Sigma. He had multiple Falcon punches that connected.
All right. Yeah. I completely forgot about that.
We lost our mind. Like, he was just throwing about, and people were like, I got it. So, oh, man. Yeah, that was a lot of fun. We're going to play again today. So definitely come through. Check us out, guys. And, you know, even if you don't play, it's a lot of fun to watch us just lose their minds over big hits. If you do play, come on in. Low stress. It's the dojo. It's training time, all right? Hey, don't worry about it.
We'll encourage you. We'll give you tips if you want them. Ask, yeah. Come in. Let us rate you if you want or not. We can either not do that if that's what the thing you're scared about. So,
yeah. So that's what I got. Check me out.
You guys can find me on pretty much all social media at SigmaGears9. You can find me on Facebook at Sigma and Sun. And you can find all the reviews that I do on Escapist Magazine's YouTube channel, as well as EscapistMagazine.com. I want to just thank the audience once again for tuning in. I want to thank my host, Jeff. Thanks, Blue. That's it for episode 27. Peace.
Adios.
Trying to get rid of me, but I am the epitome of acidity. I could spat it in every city. I had a dream and a scene. Just what I'm finna be, the shit is obscene. I'm on the scene and maybe